Okay, good afternoon. Welcome, everybody. My name is Sonja Schmid. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Science, Technology, and Society at Virginia Tech here in Northern Virginia. And I'm excited to welcome you all to SIREN. This is the 17th event in a series of seminars, talks, and discussion on nuclear emergency response. The series is part of my NSF Career Award on globalizing nuclear emergency response. And in the spirit of this type of grant, we emphasize the importance of both research and education in the area of nuclear emergency preparedness and response. So all our SIREN speakers, including the one standing next to me, who has the microphone, that's why I'm so close to him.
We're just close friends.
are meeting with graduate students as part of their engagement, and we plan to provide access to a recording of their lectures. SIREN stands for the Seminar on Interdisciplinary Research and Education in Nuclear Emergency Response. It's generously supported by Virginia Tech's Office of the Vice President for the National Capital Region. Many thanks to the staff of the Virginia Tech Research Center's Executive Briefing Center and the IT team for their support. To the students, staff, and faculty in our department and nuclear engineering for helping to make this happen. Today's talk will be live streamed. We have about 60 remote participants signed up as of this morning. These attendees are joining us not only from our main campus in Blacksburg, from other universities in the US, federal agencies, and national labs, but also from abroad. So welcome. If you're watching us online and would like to submit a question or a comment to the speaker, please send an email indicating your name and affiliation to siren@vt.edu. That's siren@vt.edu. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today. It's very unusual to look up.
That's for most.
So Luis Garcia is the Seaburn Support Branch Chief for the Chemical, Biological, Radiological, and Nuclear Program Office within the Response Directorate of FEMA, where he's responsible for developing and maintaining special programs focused on nuclear, radiological, chemical, and biological hazards. He's been with FEMA for the last 8 years and served as the lead planner for the Nuclear Radiological Incident Annex, which he will talk about today, as well as the Biological Incident Annex. Mr. Garcia also led the effort in developing the National Planning System. Prior to joining FEMA, he spent more than 20 years with the American Red Cross, serving in various capacities, including being selected as the executive director for the American Red Cross Rappahannock, area chapter in Fredericksburg, Virginia. He also managed the American Red Cross HQ Plans and Performance Division with the responsibility of providing planning, evaluation, and exercise guidance to more than 900 Red Cross offices in the United States and its territories. Luis also has a special relationship with Virginia Tech. Almost 10 years ago, following the April 16th shootings on the main campus in Blacksburg that killed 33 people, injured many more, and traumatized the university community, he directed the American Red Cross relief operations and coordinated over 200 mental health professionals to provide grief counseling to students and families. Please join me in welcoming Luis Garcia.
Great, thank you. Appreciate it. And I need to grab this. Thank you, Sonja. It was interesting as we were coming in this morning. That was one of the aspects that I didn't provide early on, is that relationship with Virginia Tech, which was so crucial during that time. But thank you for mentioning that. Once again, I appreciate the time to come and talk to you about some of the things that the federal government and FEMA and our interagency partners have accomplished over the last 3 or 4 years when it comes to nuclear radiological preparedness and preparedness in regards to response. One of the things that I'm going to focus on today is mostly on an IND type incident. Improvised nuclear device and the response and the collaboration coordination that we'll be having during those times. So just keep that in mind. The annex itself that we've developed is actually an annex that is pretty much cross-cutting when we're talking about radiological incidents. So could be terrorism, could be accidental or an international incident, and I'll talk a little bit more about that as we go through the presentation. So some planning assumptions that that I want you to keep in mind as I'm going through this. The first half of the presentation is just going to give you a background, more than likely, on stuff that you've already experienced with other presenters over the last year or so. Sonia mentioned that this is the 17th presentation, so I'm almost positive that some of the slides that that I have you've probably seen before, but I'm going to use them in a different context. I'm going to be using them to be able to look at how the federal government would respond. So some planning assumptions. A lot of folks really don't understand how an actual IND response is going to play out. It's very different. We've never had a major nuclear event here in the U.S., so it's kind of difficult for folks to really understand how that would work. With that being said, there are some common themes that we have in regards to a nuclear radiological response. So when you're talking about sheltering in place, that happens in many instances, and it would happen as well during a nuclear radiological event. Evacuation, as we're looking at evacuations, making the decisions of when, I think, is different as we move on through the process. The other aspect is the establishment of a federal, state, local organizational structure. That is not going to change. It's still the same as you're looking at locals being there immediately, and the type of response that they would receive from the state emergency management structure and as well as the federal structure. That's going to be very, very similar as we look at radiological versus an all-hazards approach. Social behavior components, I think, make planning very, very difficult. The aspect of the Hollywood effect, what you see in movies, is very, very, very different, and it's portrayed in a very extreme fashion when it comes to nuclear radiological incidents. So that's very difficult. And as with any life incident or exercise, one of the important aspects is the sharing of information. If you're not sharing information in regards to the incident and what is occurring, lives will be lost. So it's very important that we look at that, and I'll talk a little bit about that more as I go through the through the presentation. And finally, awareness and training is key. Knowledge of available tools, the resources that are available is absolutely essential to be able to make the right decision. So I just want to make sure that we kept those planning assumptions in mind. So as we look at IND effects, we use a 10KT situation for planning purposes when we were developing the annex. And as we look at this, when we're talking about effects, we're looking at about 100% 100% fatality rate within half a mile of ground zero. And what I mean by ground zero, and you've probably heard this in the past, is the area where you're going to have a detonation. So half a mile from that, pretty close, if not complete, 100% fatality rate. As we're looking at how big is a 10KT, so if, well, some of you may not remember, but when we were looking at Oklahoma City back many years ago, that situation, a 10KT is 5,000 times that size. So keep that in mind when we're talking about a 10KT. And then the significant challenges that we're going to have with an IND. We're talking about displaced citizens, the receiver communities, and what I mean by that is those states and other communities that are going to be accepting or receiving folks that are outside of the impacted area. And then recovery and restoration is going to be a very challenging situation for us. And one other aspect is economic impact. Probably the worst, or this will be worse than any of the incidents that we've had, and the worst one for us being Hurricane Katrina. Much, much worse than that when it comes to economic recovery and disaster disaster response. So keep that in mind as well. So as I said, the IND scenario, we're talking about a 10 KT yield, once again, the equivalent of about 5,000 Oklahoma City truck bombs. It's going to be a, and the situation or the area that I'm going to be using is Chicago. I think the last presenters here over the last few presentations have talked about D.C. Wanted to get outside of D.C. so you get a perspective of what we're looking at. And the actual weather data was roughly January 15, 2009, Thursday, normal work day. And as we look at casualty numbers and things like that, you'll see that those numbers were derived from a daytime population or daytime population estimates. So this particular situation gives you an understanding or a view of the damage zones that we look at when it comes to INDs, and you've probably had some conversations with this in the past, but the severe damage zone, we're talking about major damage, we're talking building collapse, and in this area you're going to have the highest number of fatalities, which is ground zero to basically half a mile out from that. We're also looking at the moderate damage zones. You're still going to have some significant structural damage. You're going to have overturned cars, and you're probably going to have fires anywhere from half a mile to a mile out from ground zero. The next area, as we look at, is the outer edge of the damage zone. We're talking about basically blast damage. You're going to have some broken windows. You're going to have possible radiation and burn injuries out that far. And the image that you see here is basically an area that we're looking at right outside of the severe damage zone. And there we go. So moderate damage zone. As I mentioned earlier, this is one of the areas that you'll see is going to be a challenge. This is just a very, very short video on what would happen as you see the blast. You see the information on the moderate damage zone that goes into the windows. You're going to have glass and structural damage that's going to be raining down on folks. So that's going to be a huge challenge as we look at other facilities and other buildings that would be in a similar situation when we look at the moderate damage zone. So as we look at the, I think we missed one there, maybe not. The light damage zone is basically outer boundaries that extend from about 1 mile to about 3 miles from ground zero. Damage there is basically going to be caused by a shock wave, basically it's going to be minor glass, minor damage, but we're still going to have some type of a radiological impact. As an example, this was actual pictures that were taken from a facility in Henderson, Nevada back in 1988. And this was roughly, I believe it was a couple of miles outside of the impact or the explosion. And as you see, this is very similar to a situation that we would see in the light damage zone. I also wanted to talk a little bit about fallout patterns. Once we have the explosion, you see there some of the areas that we're looking at, the blast shock wave within the damage zones. You also are going to have the fireball that's going to go directly up several miles. It's going to be debris in the clouds that's going to be raining down on the street level. So very, very challenging situation. And as here, we'll see the issues that we would have in regards to fallout. The heavier impacts will come to the ground fairly quickly, the particles, and then the lighter particles will be carried further away as time passes. The next slide here will give you a perspective And keep an eye on the upper right-hand corner that provides you some of the timing that would occur after an explosion. As you see the fallout particles and the fallout cloud going out to 4 hours, 5 hours, so on and so forth. 6 hours, you see that it's gone into Michigan, Indiana, those areas, southern Ohio, so on and so forth. But as time goes by, the situation will slowly, slowly recede as we're going through that process. So as you see there, 18 hours, so on and so forth. So once again, severe damage zones, moderate, light, and here it'll give you an opportunity to see the dangerous fallout, which can go out 10 to 20 miles in regards to the distance from ground zero where radioactive fallout was present earlier. So where are the injured that we can basically help the most? I was talking earlier about the severe damage zone. As you see the graph there, mostly 100% fatalities going from ground zero to about half mile out. As we look at the moderate damage zone, the situation gets a little better. We're talking about roughly 60-65% survivability within the moderate damage zone. And of course, as we get into the light damage zone, the numbers are much, much better. 100% survivability in one sense or another. But there's still going to be some impacts as we look at light damage, as we look at radiation, and as we look at recovery operations that may occur in those particular areas. So, planning considerations as we move forward on this, and just to give you a perspective, this was in regards to the different weather patterns over a one-year period in the Chicago areas, and as you see, it's probably going to be quite a few. As we look at this, February, March, April timeframe, May timeframe, winds are everywhere. So as you're looking at responses, you're looking at planning considerations, you just can't plan for one specific area when you're talking about setting up staging areas or setting up camps where our responders would be. Very, very difficult, many, many possibilities. And as we went through the planning process, we took a lot of these things into consideration. So why did I show you all of that information? And I have a guest here with John McKinney that was able to part of the planning group as we went through this process. So if I get anything wrong, I know that you'll be able to correct me on some of the information. So anyway, the history of the NRIA. This process goes back to the mid-90s when it was called the Federal Radiological Emergency Preparedness Plan, or because we're so good in acronyms, it was the FERP. I hate acronyms, but we have to use them in the federal government. So the other aspect was we've gone through several iterations of the NUCRAD Incident Annex starting in 2004. Most of those documents were mostly policy or regulatory. We just talked about roles, responsibilities, and things like that, but we really didn't talk about how the federal government was going to respond to a nuclear radiological event above and beyond nuclear power plants. The NRC, the nuclear power plant industry, and others have done a really good job over the years to prepare not only themselves, but prepare communities to respond to a nuclear power plant incident. But in this case, we wanted to go a little further as we were developing the Nuclear Radiological Incident Annex. And the iteration that we currently have, the annex that I'm going to be talking about, is very much more operational in nature, and we'll talk about how that would work in the future. So the scope of the NRIA, I talked a little bit earlier about the different types. It's very comprehensive, very, very comprehensive as we look at the types of incidents and the things that we would be responding to in this particular situation. So we're talking inadvertent, when we're talking nuclear power plants, research facilities, those types of things, research and test reactors, transportation incidents, and there's a lot of, and some of you may know this, but there's a lot of either materials or of a radiological nature that may be moved throughout the Midwest and the U.S. One of the other aspects that we look at is the deliberate attack. So we're talking terrorism, whether it's an IND, RDD, or whether it's a hostile act versus or on a nuclear power plant. We talk about those things, and the responses are going to be fairly similar as we look at NUCRAD type incidents. And one of the new aspects that we've added into this planning process is international incidents, and not necessarily the U.S. responding to something outside the country, but more the impacts of what the U.S. would do. And something very similar to a Fukushima. There were some issues within the U.S. When that occurred, mostly around information sharing. And I talked earlier about the importance of information sharing, but there were challenges with our state and local partners, especially on the West Coast, having an understanding of what the impact would be on their states, on their local communities. So we're addressing that. We have an understanding who has primary responsibilities and so on and so forth. So very, very comprehensive as we look at the scope of the NRIA. How are we going to cover all of that information within one document? It wasn't easy. Very, very difficult, in fact, and having an understanding of how we would break it out. So basically, as some of you may have experience with federal plans, when you're talking DORSOPs, 500 pages worth of a document, we didn't want to go that far. So actually, this document is roughly less than 200 pages, and it's four plans in one. Basically, we have the base annex, the NUCRAD incident annex, that has all of the cross-cutting responsibilities, all of the cross-cutting actions that you would use in any of the branches. So when you're talking about operational coordination, when you're talking critical information requirements, when you're talking decision-making points, when you're talking about who has primary authority, and there's a lot of agencies when we're talking about nuclear radiological incidents that have primary responsibility, and they're all different. So when you're talking the Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, when you're talking NRC, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, when you're talking DHS, who has primary responsibility, and we, working for FEMA under the umbrella of DHS, have responsibility for coordination. You have FBI that has the criminal investigation portion. So we had to have all of those discussions with all of those agencies to make sure that we were on the same page. So I talked earlier about the deliberate branch. The deliberate branch has specific information that is above and beyond what we have in the base annex. We wanted to make sure that we separated the information so as our partners look at the annex, we can give them a fairly good understanding of how we're going to respond to a deliberate incident. Working in conjunction with the FBI, working with the in conjunction with DHS, others, Department of Defense, so on and so forth. The second branch is the accidental. Once again, we're talking about facilities, we're talking transportation, we're talking NASA. Nobody really takes into account the rockets that go up that may have radiological cargo. What would happen if something like that would explode? And how would we deal with that type of situation? And then, of course, I talked about the international branch where we look at ultimate responsibility, and it's a shared responsibility because we're looking at the State Department, who has responsibility in working with our international partners, and then EPA and Coast Guard, interestingly enough, who have responsibilities for our coastal areas and the areas within the U.S. So very, very unique aspects as we develop the plan. So as we were going through this process, there were some key issues, some key challenges that we had in the development of the plan. And I talked earlier about the FBI criminal investigation versus response and recovery. So how are those various incidents, or how are they going to be managed? How are we going to get all of the interagency partners to really have an understanding of what we do? So that's one of the reasons that we developed the different branches and looked at the roles, responsibilities, and authorities. So how are interagency partners, how are they going to access the incident area or a crime area? How are we going to work with FBI to make sure that their investigation is going to be solid, but we still have to look at life safety, life-sustaining situations as we go in there? So that was one of the major issues. We talked about protocols. We talked about equipment. We talked about the expertise needed to monitor responders. And I was having a conversation earlier before we started the session about monitoring, about agencies, about what's out there, what's available. But we wanted to have an understanding of who ultimately has responsibility on that. One of the things that hasn't been done in a very long time in the U.S., and we can go back to the civil defense days, is pre-incident preparedness for a nuclear radiological event. Can anybody tell me if there's anything recently that's been put out there besides Ventura County in California? There isn't a lot of preparedness for our communities to be able to be ready. So although it's not something that we included in the plan or in the annex, it is something that we shared with our interagency partners on something that we really need to do fairly quickly if we're going to be looking at responding to this type of event. The more informed that our population is, I'm not going to say that it's going to be a much better response to the incident, but it's going to be done in a more coordinated fashion if our constituents, our communities have an understanding of what's going to be occurring during an IND, RDD, that type of situation. One of the things that we learned very early on is there's a limited capability to be able to respond to a nuclear radiological event, especially in the damage zones. We can bring all kinds of stuff right outside, but as we look at the capabilities within the areas, they're very limited, and I'll show a slide here in a second in regards to the agencies that would probably be responding within the zones that I mentioned earlier, the severe, moderate, light, and then the dangerous fallout zone. So there's a limited capability to respond in those zones. There's going to be agencies or interagency missions that are going to be occurring at the very same time. And who are they going to be depending on to conduct their missions? Department of Defense. Department of Defense has all of the really cool toys to move people from point A to point B. But they're going to get slammed with requests from interagency partners to move their resources, move their teams, move their equipment. So we've identified some ways that we would be able to look at that. And then they're going to have limited capability or capacity to be able to support multiple missions, especially if they may be overseas dealing with some of the issues that may be outside of the U.S. So we used two different work groups that were able to help us through that process. We had a resource prioritization work group, and then we had the response posture work group. So one of the things that we do with FEMA, we have to create something for everything. And one of the things that we did in the FEMA construct, in the development of our the National Response Framework and the Federal Interagency Operations Plans, and the different missionaries. There are five missionaries that the federal government looks at for response, recovery, and those types of things. So we're talking about the prevention mission area. We're talking about the protection mission area, response, recovery, and mitigation. There's a plan for every single one of those missions. One of them is classified, led by the FBI, because we want to make sure that that information doesn't get out. So within that, core capabilities have been developed. There are 32 core capabilities that are across the spectrum of the mission areas. The ones that we're focusing on here are pretty much response and recovery. And we wanted to make sure that as we move through the process, as we look at a response, that we focused on those mission areas. And one of the most important mission areas for us is not operational coordination. We'll get to that. Situational awareness. If you don't know what's occurring in an incident, it's going to be very difficult for you to build a response or a coordination element to be able to do that. So we felt that that was very important as we were going through the process. The other aspect is, as we look at this, is the public information and warning. Basically getting messaging out to the communities that something has occurred and what should they do. If we're not providing accurate information to our communities, something as simple as sheltering in place, or something as a little more difficult, evacuating, and where do you evacuate, without having a clear understanding as how we do that, it's very, very difficult to do everything else. As we look at operational communications, as we look at operational coordination, very, very difficult. As we go through an operation and as we get past the first 24, 96, after we get past the first week, then a lot of this information is going to be more decisive. So we may switch things around. 96 hours down the road, it may be more important that we look at operational coordination, or as we look at mass care, or as we look at critical transportation. But without that awareness, and without sharing information and providing the accurate, clear information to our communities, then a lot of the other stuff is going to be a whole lot more difficult. My cheat sheets. The second group. I talked earlier about the agencies that have a role to play or are bringing resources to the table. When we're talking an IND, very limited. Same situation when we're talking about a nuclear power plant incident and we're sending folks in. Very, very, very limited in regards to who's going in. And we got to this by asking a very basic, simple question as we were going through the planning process. In the severe damage zone, what agencies are gonna be going into that area? Those are the agencies that rose their hand. We have a role. We have a responsibility. And as you see, the FBI, EPA, DOE, as we're looking at monitoring, and then, of course, EPA. As we look at DOD, they may have a responsibility as we're looking at the severe damage zone. But as we spoke with them, they were looking at their roles, responsibilities in the moderate. But more teams will have responsibilities as we get further away from the from ground zero. Then, of course, we look at the light damage zone as we look at urban search and rescue, so on and so forth. So very, very, very limited as we're looking at that. And, of course, all of the teams that are within the severe, moderate, light, of course, they will be able to operate within the fallout zone. All of the other federal entities, the federal resources that we would have, they would be outside of those areas as we're looking at a response. One of the things that I don't talk about here is state and locals. They're going to be there. They're already going to be there. And the things that they're going to be looking at is life safety, life sustaining, and looking at the federal government for the resources that they would be able to bring in. One of the things that we've shared with our state and local partners, there shouldn't be an expectation that the federal government is going to be there within 24 hours when we're talking about this type of incident. It's not going to happen. Yes?
I've got a couple of remarks from our online people who are
watching. Sure.
Online. They can't see the slides very well. So if you wanted to go into the
Okay.
I wanted to spell out a few of the agencies.
Sure.
If I may add a question to this.
Sure.
Specific for an
IND.
Different, yes.
Different because the zones would be different. We're talking about, and the agencies would, no, they're very, very similar.
And the NRC is missing from this one.
Because this is IND. So, but I get your point there. Yes, yeah, so the NRC, we use the same process. As we looked at a nuclear power plant incident on who would have responsibilities, authorities, and things like that. The list that I have here, and as Sonia had mentioned, I'll mention some of the teams because it's hard to see online. We're talking FBI hazardous evidence response teams, the EPA National Counterterrorism Response Team, or the Evidence Response Team, DOE Aerial Monitoring System, the EPA Fixed Wing. Those are all in the severe damage zone. As we move away from ground zero and get into the moderate damage zone, we're talking about the DOD Seaburn Enterprise as a whole. We're talking DOD Radiological Assistance Programs, or the RAP teams. We have the CMAT teams for EPA, the Environmental Response Teams, or the ERTs for EPA, the on-scene coordinators, and then, of course, we have FERMAC, which is a center that we have that provides support for monitoring. So as we're developing mapping and monitoring and modeling information, that's done in conjunction with FERMAC, the IMAC, the Interagency Modeling Assessment Center, as well as others that fall under the DOD umbrella. In the light damage zone, I was talking about the FEMA urban search and rescue teams and the task forces, and of course the incident support teams. And all of those teams that I mentioned actually have would be able to respond as well in the areas of the fallout zone. Everybody else, all of the other entities that we have within the federal government would be outside of those areas. We're trying to keep them out of harm's way. So the zoned approach, that's one of the other ways that we actually discussed responding to an incident. So the biggest thing for us, and if you've ever heard our previous Administrator Fugate talk about FEMA responding to an incident, It's go big, go fast, go smart. Not 100% realistic when we're talking about a nuclear, an IND, or any type of radiological incident. We can go big as long as we're outside those impact zones, the severe, moderate, light, dangerous fallout. But the most important piece is to go smart. As we're looking at responding, as we're looking at supporting state and locals, we want to be absolutely sure that we're not putting additional responders in harm's way, so we have to go very, very smart. So we use the zoned approach, severe, moderate, light, and it's the same concept as we're looking at a nuclear power plant. We're going to go smart, we're going to go quickly, but we're going to keep those resources out of harm's way, especially when we're talking ingestion pathways and so on and so forth. We want to make sure that we're keeping folks out of harm's way. And the things that we're going to be focusing on is, as I said, safety of responders, the effectiveness of responder activities, and very, very important, maximize life-saving operations. So this is just, it gives you, and if you thought it was small before for the folks online, this is really small. But basically, it's a zone approach. And are we gonna be making these slides available to the folks? So you'll have an opportunity to take a closer look. The other aspect, we can make the nuclear radiological incident annex available. It is an unclassified document. So if you have additional interest in looking at the specifics of that document, there isn't any classified information. We can work in getting you the information. But basically, we talk about here how the zone approach is going to be working. So as I talked earlier, the severe areas are going to be very, very limited in regards to operations that we will have. And this is basically, when we're talking the zone approach, we're going to be talking about the first 24 to 96 hours. So as we're looking at situational awareness, we're looking at assessing, we're looking at monitoring, we're looking at modeling, all of those things, you'll see some of the information there that is very specific into what we're doing with public information and warning, what we're doing with, for example, the request for federal assistance in the moderate and light damage zones that are going to be coming from our state and local partners. So it's going to be very, very challenging as we look at those first 24 to 96 hours. And in the plans that I talked earlier, for example, the FEMA or the Federal Interagency Operations Plan, in those documents, we actually broke out timelines and phases. So for example, when we're talking left of incident, for our military colleagues, left of boom, when we're talking phase 1A, 1B, or 1C, those are all of the activities. We're talking steady state, and then we're talking, you know, an incident right before planning right before an incident occurs. Once we get right of incident, we're talking 2-alpha, which is usually the first 24 to 96 hours, 2-bravo, which would be 96 hours to a couple of weeks, and then 2-charlie and 3, which is we start getting into the recovery phases. For an IND or for a nuclear response, those timelines are out the window because we may be looking at life safety, life sustaining. It could be going for a week, 2 weeks, so that 2-alpha time frame is going to be running a whole lot longer. We may be doing recovery operations as we get longer for years, as we look at economic recovery, as we look at relocation of communities. So it will take a long time. So when we're looking at a hurricane, or when we're looking at a tornado, or when we're looking at a flood, those timelines just don't pan out for a nuclear radiological event. Good so far? No other questions online? Okay. So a lot of things need to occur. A lot of information needs to be shared with those individuals, these agencies, first responders, state and local partners on what they need to do. So one of the elements that we took a lesson learned actually from a superstorm, Superstorm Sandy, that occurred 3-4 years ago up and down the East Coast. We had a lot of issues and challenges that occurred because of Hurricane Sandy, Superstorm Sandy. And a lot of it was around energy, and a lot of it was around fuel. So one of the things that we did during Superstorm Sandy was a very ad hoc group was put together, a task force was put together. Originally, it was a fuel task force. How were we going to get fuel into the areas for generators? How were we going to get fuel to gas stations and things like that? But it eventually ended up being energy as a whole. How do we get electricity? How do we get those power generation plants back up and running? And a lot of that takes fuel. So we had that that task force that was put together, and it was basically subject matter experts, with a big portion being Department of Defense because they were moving those assets around. But Department of Energy was a huge aspect of that. When we talked all of the other entities that had responsibility for that, we took that lesson learned and tried to figure out what type of a group, what type of a structure would we need for nuclear radiological type incidents. So task force came to mind. In the federal government, believe it or not, we don't have a lot of standing task forces when it comes to an all-hazards approach. We basically have a housing task force. So when we're looking at sheltering, when we're looking at relocation, very, very specific. The other one is waste management. So when we're talking debris, when we're talking all of those other aspects, those are two standing task forces that when we have incidents are gonna be put together. Third one now is the NUCRAD Incident Task Force. And basically, we were able to get all of our subject matter experts together, those agencies that had primary responsibility to do their job. They would be part of this. So as we look at some of the agencies, it's usually the usual suspects as we look at the membership. So FEMA, DHS, DOE, Department of Defense, USDA, HHS, and many, many others. And this is just the smaller group. As we look at the incident, we'll bring in other subject matter experts that we would need, above and beyond what the federal government would have. We would look at academia. We would look at those nonprofit organizations when we talk about American Red Cross, because we would have to bring them in for the sheltering aspect or the evacuation aspect. Those agencies that are part of VOAD, or the Voluntary Organizations Active in Disaster. We want to make sure that we're bringing in those individuals to be able to give us an understanding of how they would respond to these types of situations. So very, very important for us to not only look at the federal government for subject matter expertise, but we take a look at the whole of community to have a better understanding of what we need to do for an event. So what's the responsibility? What's the role of the task force? They are not an operational entity. I'll start with that. They're not going to go into the field, and they're not going to be telling people what to do. They are not decision makers. What the task force does is provide subject matter expertise, and it provides recommendations to our leadership, and leadership anywhere from a local mayor to a governor to regional administrators to the president to have a better understanding of the impacts of the incident and the things that they need to do to be able to make the decision better. I mean, eventually, they're one of the primary decisions when we're talking about IND, what are we going to do with that? This may sound crude, but that big smoking hole in the ground that may be occurring in a major metropolitan area, what are we going to do with that? So having the subject matter expertise from the agencies that have primary roles, responsibilities, and authorities, that's what they're going to be doing. They're not going to be superseding any of the current structures that we have, whether it's in the National Response Coordination Center, the emergency support functions that have been developed, 1 through 15, or the recovery support functions that come together very early on in a process, and we look at recovery as part of an incident. They're not superseding, they're not going to be taking over their responsibilities. Their primary responsibility is to help them make decisions to be able to get through this process. So very, very, very important that we understand what the role of the task force is going to be. So some of the decision points. I talked earlier about some of the things that are very important when I was talking about the core capabilities. I talked about situational awareness, I talked about public information warning. That's some of the things that will be taught, or this task force would be able to help leadership and others decide. So when we're talking about public information and warning, decisions that need to be made. Should we be evacuating? Should we be sheltering in place? What's the type of information that we should be providing if we're asking folks to shelter in place? Are they out of harm's way? How long is this going to be? So a lot of the information that we're talking in regards to messaging, PPE, personal protective equipment, there's going to be tons of requests that's going to be coming in for personal protective equipment from a variety of entities, whether it's federal government, whether it's governmental state entities, whether it's local entities, whether it's private sector. They're going to be asking for the same type of stuff. We're not going to have enough. So how do we prioritize? And I'll talk a little bit about, I talked earlier about some of the prioritization process, but that's some of the information that they would be assisting with. As we talk about decontamination capability, there isn't enough decontamination capability in the world to be able to deal with a 10 KT situation in a major metropolitan city. So what are we looking at? You know, are we talking about the clearance goals, the standards that we have to look at? When we talk about the Environmental Protection Agency and their protective action guide that they've developed, what are we using? How are we using it? Should we look at waivers? As we're looking at transportation, as we're looking at folks going in, what are the types of waivers that we would be looking at? And how, some of you may have heard this term, how clean is clean? How clean is clean for responders, and how clean is clean for a community, for members that are being impacted or that have been contaminated. Talking about decontamination, what type of message are we giving folks? Self-decon. What do they need to do? It's not very difficult. Taking off your clothes, that type of stuff. The very basic information for life safety, life sustaining. So we're making sure that the task force would be able to provide that type of situation. And then long-term waste management. There isn't enough space in the U.S. anywhere to be able to deal with thousands of tons of contaminated debris. Where are we going to put it? Are we going to cement it over? So there's a lot of situations that we look at, and the folks that that would be assisting senior leaders in making those decisions would be part of this task force. And once again, decision-making capabilities not there. It's recommendations and support. Yes, sir.
Key decision points.
Yes.
I understand that. Are you saying this is the list of things we have to worry about and somebody ought to be thinking about it? Or is there a list of things to worry about and here's the answers that we put together at this point that we're going to share?
Great question. And the the question is the key decision making, is that, do we have answers? I'll summarize. Do we have answers in the annex to be able to, this is how we're going to respond to these particular situations, or is it things that we should be thinking about? It's both, actually. Normally in the planning process, and if any of you have participated in the writing of a plan or an annex or whatever, one of the interesting things that happens is if we get into a situation or a question that's really tough to answer, or we don't have an answer, we're going to kick that can down the road and let somebody else deal with it. Normally how planning works. When we got to this particular situation, what we wanted to do was not kick that can down the road because this was too important. So what we developed within the annex is key decision points, some that had answers, but others that senior leaders really needed to look at. The prioritization, for example, of PPE. The decision-making process, because there's when you're looking at the annex, when you take an opportunity to read through it, there are certain things that you can't answer in advance. You can't answer the aspect of evacuation, that you're going to evacuate within 3 hours or within a day. You can't answer those things, but you have to make decisions on that. The decisions of prioritization of responders that need to get personal protective equipment. You really can't make the decision in advance because you have to have an understanding and looking at the situational awareness. So in regards to your question, it's both. We were able to identify some answers to some of the questions, but the others, we have some decision points, and we've identified who ultimately has responsibility for dealing with that, whether it's EPA, whether it's the White House, whether it's Department of Homeland Security, whether it's Department of Defense. We've identified the individuals that need to be part of the decision-making process, but those are things that we would have to identify very, very early on in the incident. So hope that answers your question.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Somebody supposed to be expert to discriminate whether it's ID or IRD?
So the outcomes are different, right? And that's a very good point. And I think your question was in regards to the differences between an IND and an RDD. Right. You know, it's interesting because as we went through this process, it's still the same concept. When we're looking at response, recovery, all of that stuff, just the incidents are smaller. So when we're talking IND, very large. I'm sorry? It would depend. You're absolutely right. It would depend. But as we were looking at an improvised nuclear device, 10 kT, not that it's the worst of worst, but it's going to be a pretty bad day for any city in the U.S., anywhere in the world. So when we're talking about dispersal devices, and I think that's what you're referring to, the dispersal devices, radiological dispersal devices, you're absolutely right. The difference is that the damage, if there's an explosion on a radiological dispersal device, it's a smaller impact. For an explosion between a 10 kT and a RDD?
It depends how much explosion.
Correct. Correct. Absolutely. But the process for us to be able to respond, you're still looking at damage zones. You're still looking at severe, moderate, light. The footprint may be bigger. In regards to that sense, but we're still gonna ensure that we're providing the resources necessary, but keeping life safety, life sustaining, and keeping responders in mind when we're looking at the response. So there's when it comes to radiological incidents, there are going to be a lot of it depends. One of the questions that we received when I did a presentation down in South Carolina in preparation for an exercise down there, the only thing that that the state had requested was, don't care about anything else, what are the feds bringing to the table? My answer, it depends. It depends on how big, it depends on how small, it depends, there's a lot of intricacies when we're talking to when we're talking about radiological events, that it's very difficult for us to say with an absolute, without a doubt, that we're going to respond in this particular way, that we're going to be sending 2,000 responders into a particular area. So there are going to be differences in any type of radiological event, whether it's a nuclear power plant, whether it's an RDD. Whether it's an IND, but what we're trying to develop with the task force, what we're trying to develop with the radiological incident annex is that there is consistency in the way that we're going to respond. Having an understanding of who has ultimate responsibilities and authorities is very key up front. Who is going to be the primary agency that's going to lead the effort to look at that, and how are we going to be looking at the resources, the messaging, the agencies, the support, so on and so forth. So you're absolutely right, and by me saying that, is it going to be different? Maybe. Is it going to be the same? I don't know. But being able to put the framework together, and that's what we've done with the annex, is to provide the framework. To have not a 100% absolute, this is how it's going to be, but giving us the left and right boundaries and the understanding that agencies have responsibilities to conduct their mission. And what we at FEMA, under DHS, what we have done is to have a better understanding of what those roles and responsibilities and authorities are, so we can coordinate the response. FEMA is not a subject matter expert. I don't want to say subject matter expert to anything. We do have some subject matter expertise, but it's mostly around the coordination aspect. We're very good at having an understanding of what agencies, what responsibilities, how we're going to respond. The agencies have the responsibility of understanding or telling us if we're going in a wrong direction when it comes to things, when it comes to INDs or even biological incidents or chemical incidents. So very important for us to understand. So as we look at support to key decision making, some of these situations are going to be similar, whether it's an RDD, RED, or whether it's an IND. We still need to have an understanding of incident characterization. How is that going to work? The protective actions that we're going to be looking at, whether it's an RDD, RED, IND, nuclear power plant incident, we still have to look at that. Radiation exposure, impacts on resource allocation, as we're talking about evacuation and sheltering, that process is still going to be the same. We're still going to have to really look at how that's going to work. The health effects, as we're working with HHS and others, what are those health effects going to be as we're looking at critical information requirements? And then re-entry and reoccupation. It's not going to be different. We still have to have an understanding, whether it's RDD, whether it's RED, whether it's IND, whether it's a nuclear power plant, whether it's a rocket that goes up, explodes, and we have radiological contamination all over the place. We really need to have an understanding on that. So as I talk about the decision-making process, as I talk about the NUCRAT incident annex, just keep in mind that there are going to be differences. But what we're trying to do is to develop a system of consistency to be able to provide the framework to really respond to any type of nuclear radiological incident, with an understanding that we may have to adjust as we're moving along. Good. For the federal government, there's different levels of response. Level one, level two, level three. Worst type of situation, we're talking level one, catastrophic. And that's what we're going to be looking at. And the NRITF members, the task force members, are going to be expected to support for on-the-ground response. So those situations that are occurring on the ground, those decisions that need to be made at the headquarters level, they're going to deal with those critical information requirements. So I talked earlier about the FBI and the conversations that we had with the FBI and others. One of the things that we wanted to look at was that mission area integration, and I talked about the five mission areas: prevention, protection, response, recovery, mitigation. One of the important aspects that we really needed to make sure that we were closely aligned was with incidents that occur, suspected federal terrorism, or as we look at the law enforcement aspect, we wanted to make sure that as we're looking at left of incident and the coordination aspect that would occur, that we are closely aligned with that. FEMA has a team that's called the Consequence Management Coordination Unit, or the Consequence Management Coordination Home Team. We have the responsibility of working with the FBI under their Weapons of Mass Destruction Strategic Group to ensure that there is sharing of information in a classified way. So as we're moving from the prevention piece, as we're moving to response, if for some reason we can't stop the bad guys from something happening, then we want to make sure that we're ready to go into the response and recovery areas fairly quickly. So we've ensured that we've integrated some of the information from the FBI within this annex. So in Annex 1, as we're looking at that, or I'm sorry, Branch 1, there's a lot of information in regards to how we would align with law enforcement in looking at the response and recovery aspects of an incident. How many of you are familiar with Gotham Shield? Gotham Shield, the exercise, Gotham Shield. Large exercise that's going to be occurring next month. It deals with an improvised nuclear device going up, going off in the northeast area. There's a lot of sub exercises that are part of that. DOD, FBI, and others that would look at different ways on how we would respond to that type of incident occurring in a major metropolitan area. One of the things that we're going to be testing as part of that process, especially for us, for the interagency, is the NUCRAD Incident Annex and the Nuclear Radiological Incident Task Force. We want to walk through, and this is probably the third time that we've actually looked at this annex, we want to walk through the process of how the annex would be used, how the task force would be used, how we work with the interagency, how we work with states and locals, how we work with the FBI and the left of incident, how are we working with Department of Defense and others as we look at the movement of resources and things like that. So it's going to be almost a two-week period. But the main piece for us is be roughly April 24th. So we'll take an opportunity to really walk through this process, which is really exciting for us. The annex, and I didn't talk about this earlier, but it took a long time. It was originally planned for 1 year, the development with 1 year. It took 3.5. Because of all of the issues and all of the situations that we ran into, all of the challenges, the agencies, the negotiations, so on and so forth. But fortunately for us, the annex was just approved by the White House, and that was part of the negotiation process that we had to go through the White House to make sure that some information was included. But it was just approved by the White House in November. So this will be the first time post approval that we'll get an opportunity to really take a look at it. I want to thank everyone for, and I'll get to that for a second. I just want to thank everyone for having me ramble on about something that's been near and dear to my heart for the last 4 years. This is important for us. This is important to share this type of information. You know, normally when we look at plans, when we look at annexes, when we look at task forces, we're not very good at sharing. We've probably done more sharing over the last 3 years with state and local partners, with academia, with others, than we've ever done in the history of developing plans. So I want to thank Sonia. We've been working on this for 6-7 months now, roughly. We've had these conversations. So just wanted to make sure that I thanked everyone for that. Yes.
I had a question.
Widespread support. A lot of the.
Can I just make one quick announcement?
Yes.
Since we have trouble with the microphone, we don't have a handheld microphone today. I apologize. There was a flood in the IT room, and we are on a backup system. So apologies to everybody.
Repeat the question. Okay.
Yes.
I'm sorry. Say, ask again.
Just under the, you know, it was approved November 2016.
Yes. Yes. The question is, with the approval in 2016 with the old administration, does the new administration have widespread support? Short answer is yes. Some of the players that sat on the National Security Council committees that had responsibility for this are still there. Same individuals, new directors that have come in, but some of them have come from either our office or DHS or others. So there is widespread support for this annex and the others that we've done under ChemBio.
Okay, I need to get close to the microphone again. So for our online participants, please, if you have a question or a comment for the speaker, you can email it to siren@vt.edu. We have one question from Bill Beal, who is a principal scientist at the Remote Sensing Laboratory at Andrews.
Mm-hmm.
How does the staffing of the Nuclear and Radiological Incident Task Force
at the NRCC affect the ability of the Interagency Advisory Team for Environment, Food, and Health, the so-called A-Team, to support the affected states directly?
That is a great question. And I'll make up an answer. No, I'm kidding. We've actually worked with the advisory team. The advisory team was a core planning team member as we developed the annex. The current, and I may get his title wrong, but Captain Noska, the current chair, has actually been closely involved. So in regards to the impact, there isn't any. Those individuals will still be deployed to state and local emergency operations centers, whether they're working with public health or whether they're working with emergency managers. We're looking at only having one individual, possibly two, from the advisory team that would be part of the NUCRAD Incident Task Force. So so the impact would be limited. Other questions? Yes, sir. I'll go here, and then I'll go here.
Just one other question, then. The response to the event that you outlined is very similar in sort of construct to a lot of other disasters with the unique components of radiation, et cetera. But wouldn't there be, like, widespread panic? Wouldn't there be huge population shifts that you would have a hard time just saying, stay where you are, everything's okay? How does your plan, you know, and your planning for this event...
Right. Yeah. So the question is, the plan, the annex that we developed is very similar to what we do with all hazards events. Absolutely right. But how do we deal, how does the annex deal with populations and the potential for panic and or widespread panic? Absolutely right. It's all about information sharing, and it's all about the messaging. When I talked earlier about the two primary core capabilities that we looked at, situational awareness and public information and warning, one of the things that we've developed probably over the last couple of years are two major documents, communicating in the aftermath of a nuclear power plant incident and communicating in the aftermath of an improvised nuclear device. Those two documents give you a framework of how to deal with those types of situations. What we're trying to do and what we've done with our external affairs partners, whether it's FEMA, whether it's Department of Homeland Security, or whether it's the public information officers from our interagency partners, we have a communications work group that actually talks and deals with the type of information and the types of situations that that you just mentioned in regards to panic or mass confusion or getting folks to get out of the area. Can we ever stop that from happening? No, not really. But can we provide the best information possible so the individuals that are receiving the information, so they can make the right decisions for themselves and their families? I think that's the best that we can do. And providing those messages, if we have to do it pre-event, because there's the possibility that we may have to provide information pre-incident, but more than likely we have to provide very solid information right of incident or after an incident occurs. Yeah. Yes, they are. Yes, they are.
Patrick Roberts of Virginia Tech.
Yes.
How does your plan address communications, and particularly cases where a state and local partner or an industry partner might say something incorrect or that could be misinterpreted?
The question is, within the annex, do we have information in there in regards to a state and local partner or anybody else that would be able, that is providing inaccurate information and how we would be able to deal with that. That's a very, very difficult situation, and we've seen that currently in another type of incident in the Zika virus disease. If you saw any of the information that was going out, there was a lot of discrepancies between state and local public health officials, the CDC, HHS, others. It's a difficult situation because we can't control what may be occurring at the state and local level. Once again, what we can provide them is the most accurate information that would be coming out of the federal government. Once again, the annex deals specifically with how the federal government will respond to an incident. We didn't incorporate any of the state and local response because it's different. They're going to be there immediately. They're considered first responders. The federal government, probably not within the first 72 hours are we going to have resources in place. We'll have some to include public information officers and things like that, but it's going to be very hard to try and manage the message from a federal perspective and then try and have the same message and manage that message at a state and local level. It's very limited. The document that I talked about, communicating in the aftermath of an IND, that's basically what that document is. It provides the framework on how to communicate with that. We'll probably be updating that document within the next few months, so we can start looking and addressing some of the issues that you just mentioned, providing the support necessary to states and locals to be on the same page. But I still think it's going to be difficult. Yes.
Okay, we have one other online question from Deborah Decker, who is actually attending the NRC, Rick, as we speak, and has called in for this seminar.
Very nice. Welcome.
She asks, how will CERT, the Citizen Emergency Response Teams, used or utilized in the zone, or whether at all?
Yeah, that's interesting. Most of those teams are local in nature. So when you're talking about those the response teams, those are built into local plans. In some cases, they'll be built into the state plan. So if state and local partners have developed nuclear radiological incident annexes, they would probably be used in that sense. And in many cases, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think most of those are volunteers that actually participate in that. So we need to be very careful as we're working with our volunteer partners and making sure that we're not putting them in harm's way. But more than likely, with the CERTs, they would be used under the umbrella of our local emergency management partners and how they're used in that particular situation. Yes, sir.
Two questions. One, the first, a short one. Who would be the overall leader of the task force?
Very good question. The question was, in regards to the task force, who would be the primary agency or the lead agency? It depends. it depends on it can probably change as we're going through an incident. Could be Department of Homeland Security, depending on what we're looking at. It could be, if we're talking a nuclear power plant, could be NRC for that initial response. But as we're moving through the process and as we start getting into recovery, could be EPA. When we start getting into the cleanup, the consistency aspect of the task force would be there's a co-lead, and the co-lead is FEMA for the coordination of the response. So FEMA will always be there, but as we're going from the first 24 hours, it could be Department of Energy because we're looking at monitoring capabilities. We should be looking at modeling. We should be looking at the at FERMAC. So it could be DOE within those first 24, 48, 96 hours. After we start moving into operations, it can change. If we're looking at an incident where we're talking law enforcement, FBI is still going to have primary responsibility when we're talking law enforcement, but DHS can have a primary role as we're looking at dealing with the IC portion or the aspect of working hand in hand with counterterrorism and CT. So, but the whole constant through this would be FEMA. And your second question.
For all the alphabet soup of DOE.
Yes.
DOE, DHS.
Yes.
Under the plan, will they self-deploy or does someone have to tell them?
Wow, another very good question. The question was with the alphabet soup of agencies, whether they will self-deploy or not. Yes and no. Yes to those agencies that have statements of understanding with states and locals, for example, Department of Energy would have an opportunity to self-deploy because of the monitoring capabilities. There may be other agencies that are going to self-deploy. In most instances, they're going to wait because deploying takes money. And without having some type of a presidential declaration where funding is made available, although more than likely for this type of event, the president would declare an area level one Stafford Act type declaration where funding is made available to be able to respond. But there's a handful of agencies that would self-deploy in this particular situation, but they're very, very limited, very limited. And it's going to be dependent on what their role is and the agreements that they have with state and local partners. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Candidly, I was very surprised at the level of EPA involvement in the moderate and the severe zone.
Mm-hmm.
As primarily a regulatory agency.
Right, right.
Thoughts?
We've actually spelled out both. We have the what we've included is not only the agencies, but under what authorities, under what regulations, under what laws they respond. So within the annex, we've included those regulations and those laws and the agencies that have primary responsibility for that. So when we talk about the, when you're talking about EPA, they have certain primary responsibilities when we're talking about that. So the monitoring capabilities, the investigation capabilities that they have. We've spelled that out in detail, and then what they have responsibility for within the annex. So we've put a table in there that breaks it out by naturally occurring. responsibility for that one as well. Not naturally occurring, but when we're talking domestic, when we're talking international, when we're talking coastal. EPA has some responsibilities, as well as EPA. Coast Guard and EPA have similar but different. So we've spelled it out as much as we can when we talk about regulatory responsibilities. And when we talk about NRC and we talk about EPA, there are some regulatory responsibilities, but they also have operational responsibilities as we looked at. And we've spelled that out very, very clearly. And it is surprising for some folks to really see that there are some regulatory agencies that have responsibility to respond to these types of things, especially when we're talking waste management, cleanup, those types of things. And once you get a copy of the annex, and it actually has been published, I'll send you the Sonia, I'll send you the link so you can make it available to everyone. But it is a published document now. Other questions? Yes.
I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about the training of the task force members. Because beyond providing factual subject
right.
expertise, presumably they would be trained in you know, how does
yeah.
this apply in an emergency situation?
Yeah, very good. And if you didn't hear the question, Sonia asked, the training that goes along with the task force. Interestingly enough, we have a training that's coming up next Tuesday for task force members to really walk through what their roles, responsibilities, authorities are in regards to being a member of the task force. What should they know? And these folks need to be fairly knowledgeable in regards to their agency's responsibilities when it comes to nuclear radiological events. So as we're going through that, through the training, not only will we talk about what's expected, the types of situations that we would look at, but we also talk about the activation. What is the process to activate those individuals as they're going through this? Because we've never done it before in regards to this particular task force. So we have emergency support functions that are activated on a fairly consistent basis. But when we're talking this task force, it doesn't align with any of those what we call ESFs, emergency support functions. So the training piece will take them through the process of what they should be looking at, the types of questions that may be going back to their agencies, and what is their primary role as they're sitting in the National Response Coordination Center at FEMA, and having an understanding of how they will interact with all of the other hundreds of people that are going to be working in the NRCC. So there are aspects of operations. We just need to be absolutely sure that our agencies do not think that they are decision makers. We already have a boatload of decision makers within all the agencies, and when we're talking the executive branch, there's a lot of decision makers. What this task force, their primary responsibility, and I can't emphasize this enough, is to provide them the information necessary to be able to make the right decision. So we'll walk them through a training. We do exercises. We've done several exercises with the task force. We have two next week. We have one next month, as I was mentioning, Gotham Shield. And our plan is to be able to exercise the two other aspects, not only the IND or the terrorism piece, but also look at exercising the task force in a facility or a nuclear power plant type situation, as well as an international situation. How would the task force come to play if there's requests from a foreign nation that they would need support to be able to respond? Similar to what happened in Fukushima, there were requests. So how do we handle that? How do we deal with it? How do we look at ensuring that the U.S. is not going to be impacted? So we're going to test all aspects through exercises of the task force in all three elements. Other questions? Wow. This was cool. This was fun.
Well, thank you all so much for coming, and please join me in thanking our speaker.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Great, great, thank you. Let me make sure that I take this off, so. And I have to apologize. He could be a twin of, yes, he could be a twin of John McKinney, who was one of my primary...